Well, my name is Sister Rosemary Dewey, and I came to Lake Forest to the high school in 1943, and I graduated in 1947. I went on to Manhattanville College, and I have come back here at various times as a religious of the Sacred Heart. I was a day hop. I did not board. I commuted from Winnetka, and at that time there was a North Shore train running, and that stopped right out at the edge of the property here. And a lot of us, in my class anyway, and in classes below and beyond me, commuted via the North Shore train, which was a very bonding time, I think. We had a house in Winnetka that was not too far from the train, and so that made it very possible. In my senior year, my father had given me a car, so I could drive to school, but one of the regulations was I could not take anyone. Now, that at this point in time, particularly with the gas prices the way they are, that may seem ridiculous, and it, to tell the truth, seemed rather ridiculous at the time. So what I used to do is pick up my friends on the way to school and drop them off outside the gate. And then I would come in and hand the keys over to the surveyor general. And she was sort of like the disciplinarian. I suppose some of my favorite stories might be that in sophomore year, I was very athletic. And so I was on pretty much all the teams that they had. We couldn't play a lot of other teams. We could only play Sheridan Road at that time. And one time, towards the end of the basketball season, we had played our one game with Sheridan Road, and so it seemed that the coach, who was a Chinese woman at the time, wanted to take us to Chinatown, and the basketball team to Chinatown. And I think I was a sophomore, so I don't know how on earth I got a driver's license, but I had one. And so I drove. And I drove our car to, we went to Chinatown and we had a great time. And then we dropped some people off who were on the team. And then this other person that was in my class, Manny Crowley, and she's since died, or I'd suggest that you interview her because she'd have lots of stories, or she'd make them up if she didn't have them. She and I drove Miss Lowe, who was the coach, back to the campus here. Now, at that time, they had four teachers living in a cottage. We called it the cottage, and it's where Stuart Hall is at the present time. So we dropped Miss Lowe off, and in the course of the conversation, she had told us it was during the war, and she had told us that at Fort Sheridan, they had the German prisoners. And sometimes they would hear the sirens going off for the prisoners had escaped or whatever, and then they'd hear people shoveling coal in their basement, which was very terrifying to them. And they had, believe it or not, at that time they had no phone. So they had only a phone that would phone the superior here at the college or the academy at that time. And she would then phone the outside if they needed to get outside. So in any case, we dropped Miss Lowe off, and we started around the drive. And I don't know if you know where that parking place is around the corner there, but there were lots of trees in the way, and it was nighttime, and so we decided that we would go back and scare the four teachers that were living in the cottage. And so we parked the car around the curve. They couldn't see it. And we went through the woods. It was woody there. Right now it's just the grass to Stuart and to the cottage then. Stuart Hall, of course, didn't exist. And so we went up. We climbed up on the porch. There was a porch around the cottage. And we kind of banged on the windows. And, of course, they thought we were escaped prisoners. And we got them totally terrified. And then we decided that was enough. So we went were going back to the car, and we went back to the car, and I had no keys to the car. So there was nothing to do but to confess that we had been the ones that had frightened them. So we went back to the cottage, and all the way back we kept saying, because they threatened in the course of our banging on the windows, they threatened to call the police. And we kept saying, Miss Lowe, don't call the police, don't call the police. So we got back in, and she pulled us in, thinking that we were in the midst of this. And she pulled us in, and she said, you have to get in here, and there are escape prisoners outside. So she took one look at our face, and she knew that we were the escape prisoners. So she said to us, and we walked in, and of course, we watched one college teacher, Mariette LeBlanc, who I think was taught at Loyola Loyola University for a long time. And I think Miss Lowe, and there was a kindergarten teacher and some other teacher in the college that lived there. And they had a bat in their hands. I mean, they had everything they could possibly have to defend themselves. So anyway, then she said, these are the girls. She said, I've already called Reverend Mother. So then we thought, uh-oh, this is going to be fun. So I said, would you please let us look outside, because I've lost the keys to the car. So give us a flashlight or something. Well, fortunately, the keys were right there on the porch, and we were. But then she said, you'll have to wait till the police come. So we waited, and in the meantime, we watched. One of the teachers was so nervous, she was trying to light a cigarette, and she couldn't get the match near the cigarette because her hand was shaking. So anyway, finally the police came, and they knocked on the door, and they came in. And fortunately, Miss Lowe was very kind to us, and she told the police that she just left out a bit. She said we had driven her home, and she pulled us in when they heard noises and so forth. So the police said, they questioned us, and then they said, you have a Lincoln Zephyr 13092. I still remember the license number. And I said, yes. And he said, well, it's parked around there. And I think they might have been suspicious. But anyway, they went along with the story. And I said, would you please let us go home? I'm just going to get in terrible trouble with my parents for being out so late. So please let us go home. So they did. They said, we'll drive you to your car, because they didn't want us walking across there. So in any case, they drove us to the car. In the meantime, I said to Nani Crowley, Nani, don't say anything. Don't say anything to the police. Well, you'd have to know Nani, who has since died, but she is very, she's very creative. And so when they got us in the car, they kept asking us questions like, did you see them? You know, how tall were they, etc. And she'd say, oh, one was blonde and about 6 feet tall. And she was going on and on. Well, they let us off at the car, and then we got in the car and drove home. And all the way home, we just talked about what school we would go to, because obviously we were going to be expelled. And we came back to school the next day, and clearly, when we came in the school, they told us that Miss Lowe had told them the whole story, and so that they knew that we were the culprits, and we were more convinced we were going to get expelled. Well, we didn't get expelled, and they really didn't talk to us very much about it. I think they didn't know what to do with it, so they just ignored it. So that was one of my favorite incidents.